Hello, Internet, and welcome to another fantastic week-ending episode of SegaSonic Radio, the radio show that lives up to its namesake in regard to the contents of both Sega and Sonic. I am your ever-ready host, GX, a.k.a. The Spin Dash, a.k.a. one of those two, and no significant others. And yeah, we're having like a little bit of after last week's initial big giant massive blowout of happiness and joy, we're toning things down just a little bit this week. Not as many fancy crazy animations, not as many hosts, not as many backgrounds, etc., etc., etc. Never mind that I had a heck of a week with work. But I am calling this week our Pleasant Summer Jams episode. I grabbed a bunch of songs that they may not put you in the mood for summer, but they put me in the mood for summer. Just somewhere in between exciting and exhilarating and laid back and chill, often shifting between the two. So I grabbed a playlist for us this week, and I hope you enjoy. We're going to kick things off with Death Egg Zone Act 1 from Sonic Adventure and Juice Archipelago from Sonic Lost World. I will see you on the other side. Hey, sorry about that. Expletives. Wait. There we go. Why you locking up on me, Explet? Why I gotta be like that? I'm trying to have a chill summertime. And Explet's deciding to say, No, you know what? I will not accept your unmute button press. But no, our summer vibes can overcome any Explet freezing. Except no, I can't because I'm using that software. So yeah, welcome back to everyone who stepped in from who got to listen to last week's magical marathon and have popped back for another go. We are SegaSonic Radio. We are Sonic Stadium's premier. Not premiere. We went away for a bit. Well, back in the day, it was a radio station for streaming. Now it has evolved, much like a Pokemon, into a much leaner and more sustainable format. So we've got several other Light Summer Jams for you coming up. We just listened to Juice Archipelago from Sonic Lost World. I don't know about you guys. I recently went back to Sonic Lost Worlds on my Stadium streaming series, Almost Every Sonic, and it was better than I remembered it being. Whenever I originally played it, maybe it was the sting of this is the new Sonic game that's out, I like certain things that it's doing, but, and then just sort of reaching some weird mechanical elements, but going back to it, there were a lot of particularly 2D level designs in there that I actually legitimately appreciated and enjoyed. Late in the game, there was the crazy escape from Giant Zavok. There's the riding on dragon stage. There are some things in there that I didn't quite remember from my original playthrough and was delightfully impressed by. I'm not sure it elevates it above all of its weird mechanical, I'll call them nuances and being incredibly polite. But yeah, I think it's worth retrying if you passed on it at some point, especially if you can get it for cheap on Steam these days. Won't necessarily have the Yoshi content or the Zelda content, but still, I enjoyed it. I had a fun time with it. I hope you have a fun time with this next track from a game that I don't particularly enjoy and probably will not particularly enjoy when I come back to it, but I know it has its fans. We're going to listen to Sonic and the Black Knight, and more specifically, we've got the Deep Woods. We will be back on the other side. Hey. 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 Hey, hey. Hey, there we go. Thank you, microphone. So, yeah, like I said, it's been a week for me. Just those chill vibes that I need just to calm my nerves. And I even had off today. Took off specifically. I don't take off very often, but I did for today to enjoy a nice long weekend. So, hey, happy 4th of July to any American listeners who are also enjoying a nice long weekend, or at least a weekend with family. Hope you enjoy it and have a good one. If you need to fill some time on the way to travel, or just to have something else extra to listen to, go head over to sonicstadium.org, because we've got a new podcast that I would absolutely like you to listen to. It features my good friend Alex Peel, who is a writer for the site, and my good friend Evil Dr. Reef, who I've been friends and co-podcasters with for many, many years. They've gotten together and they've started a new series called Knothole Book Club. Like I said, you can go over to sonicstadium.org. It's right on the front page right now. And what they are doing is they are rereading through the Archie Sonic series. And they are doing so from the very, very beginning. And oh man, if you started the Archie series like somewhere in the middle, you are going to be in for a culture shock whenever you jump into those early, early days. I know Reef and Alex sort of described it as, yeah, this is very, it's almost proto Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog in many ways. It's absolutely proto Sonic Sat-Am. And it's just a fascinating legacy to just continue to dive into and watch how it evolves over the course of literal decades. I know they were trying to struggle to compare what the art looked like. For me, for whatever reason, the best point of comparison I could think of was the classic comic strip Heathcliff. I'm not sure why, but I felt like everything in there very much looked like the old Heathcliff strips. Just the way that people were designed and moved. And it was sort of a weird combination comedy-action series. I've got a couple more songs coming up that I hope you will enjoy. Two classics and one not quite classic, but sort of in the middle there. But starting off with some Tails Adventure. I love Tails Adventure. Tails Adventure is bizarrely one of my favorite, among my favorite Sonic games. And I'm not sure if it lives up to that reputation mechanically, but part of me just adores the idea of a Sonic-themed Metroidvania in which you play as Tails. And it very much is. It is a Metroidvania game. It is a game about you playing as Tails sort of in this strange, nothing-attached form, and then just grabbing power-ups as you go in order to upgrade and perform stronger attacks, fly longer, just complete every one of this strange, big, branching world's weird paths and challenges. So we're going to listen to Polly Mountain 1. Then we got some Sonic Drift, and it's going to be Labyrinth, but they didn't just directly remix songs from Sonic 1, even though each stage in Sonic Drift is based off of a Sonic 1 stage. Labyrinth is definitely not going to sound like Labyrinth Zone from Sonic 1, and I hope you'll be delightfully surprised. And then, to wrap up this session, we're going to have some Blue Coast Act 3 from Sonic Rivals 2. I know that a lot of people think of that series, think of that game particularly, Blue Coast Act 1, the vocal track, Race to Win, which has a surprisingly short loop. But I was listening to Blue Coast Act 3 today, and I thought, you know what? This is still a good song on its own. It fits in what we're going for. So I will see you on the other side after some 8-bit gems and PSP track. Hey, it's GX again! We just wrapped up some Blue Coast Act 3, and chat seems to be enjoying that one, so we are going to jump into some more modern music very shortly. One of the modern classics that were... modern classics. I mean, I guess that's probably fair. It's of an age now. We're gonna pop into some Sonic Color shortly. Hope you remember... Sonic Colors Ultimate comes out in September, very early September, and I'm very stoked for this. Again, this is a game I recently replayed just for streaming's sake, and had a really fun time with it. That game, yes, it has the 3D sections. I think that game's made all the better by the 2D sections, and I can say comfortably, my favorite Wisp tends to be Spike, and it's not so much that it adds a significant power, like, it doesn't help Sonic necessarily progress in a super direct way, but the idea, it does sort of bring back the classic feel of you can be a different character that has this different other ability to let you transverse in a new and interesting way. Spike's ability there being that it can just basically run Sonic up and down walls like it's the spider ball from Metroid, and I really enjoy that, particularly because you can spin dash as it and just whip around, creating this big, vibrant pink light track. sort of have the same feeling about the float wisp, being able to just grab a ring chain with that. Kind of brings back memories of Sonic Adventure 2 and Sonic Adventure 1, being able to lightspeed dash on those. Lightspeed dash? I'm going to call it lightspeed dash with the understanding that I might have gotten the wrong thing. The wrong power-up. It's some sort of ring dash. The ring dash. You all know what I mean. The ring dash. I'm not sure I necessarily understand some of the new stuff that they've added, except for I understand the tail stuff. I personally don't think that game is especially hard. But I also do understand, hey, you know what? They made a movie that was real up with the kids. It was, like, real up with the kids. And, yeah, maybe as a Sonic fan, like, I can... Look. I got all the A's in Sonic Adventure 2 back in the day when I was in high school. Not so much these days, but I can understand maybe that's not how you attract the new audience. Maybe it's nice to just experience the designs of that game and the feel of getting to pilot Drill Sonic around. Like, that's kind of what stands out to me, is that it's not that game's hard, it's just that the places where it feels good feels really, really good, and that's the part that I appreciate and look forward to. And you know what? I think that's okay that made it a bit easier. There's some weird aesthetic choices that they've not like level aesthetics, but like change Sonic gloves, change Sonic shoes, but never, you may never have a different color of Sonic. Not unless we pretend he's a robot. We can never do that. Not in Smash Brothers. Not in Sonic Colors. No, Sonic must always eternally be this blue. No. I'm just funning. But yeah, we got some Sonic Colors coming up. We've got Aquarium Park Act 1, which I've chosen because it has been stuck in my head all day. Just all day. And now you must suffer along with me. And then after that, going for an aquatic twofer, we've got Sonic Free Riders with Dolphin Resort. I'll see you guys on the other side. Hey, y'all, and welcome back. And we kicked off this episode with a new venture, the main theme of Sonic Rush Adventure. And I like to have a good mix here. I know that, hey, Sonic fans tend to be real into the vocal tracks. And I'm fine with vocal tracks. I like them perfectly fine, but I'm also prone to just liking a big mix of things. But I was trying to think of what would fit in with the nice, chill, sort of summer vibe track list here. Just sort of a good, chill playlist. And it's kind of hard to find those, because a lot of vocal tracks in here are, in Sonic, are like, we're heavy, we're Crush 40 rock, and we're gonna rock everything. Jensen now on the guitar, and lots of vocals, and, you know, and that's not quite the tone I'm trying to go for. Just not for this week. Not for this week. There'll be other weeks. I felt this one was going to be at least fairly appropriate. It is a Sonic Forces track. It is Set in Motion, which does have vocals by, if I remember correctly, Claudia Vasquez. And by remember, I mean look at my screen. So what we're going to do here is we're going to listen to Set in Motion, just that one song. And then right after that, I will be back as we start not quite the wind down, but certainly the latter half of this episode. Enjoy.
Thank you.
Hey, and we're back, and we're going to do just a quick news roundup for this week. So, it's certainly not as utterly insane a news week as earlier this June. But hey, if you're interested in the Minecraft Sonic, that is officially out. We've got some pictures up on the site of all of the costumes you can unlock. My understanding is that you do need to play the game to unlock them after you purchase them for, I believe it's about $8. We've got some concept art from Sonic Prime. So, this was a kind of a weird one. We have some pictures up on the site showing nothing confirmed as being used in the series, but there are some general layouts which should give you a bit of an idea of the tone of the show. It definitely seems to want to straddle the line between something that's a bit more action-y and something that's a bit, we'll say, comedy, funny. There's some images of a big future city where Eggman has multiple aged versions of himself that this world-traveling Sonic has gone through in this sort of, I guess, cyberpunk-style future. Tails is Tails, who is already sort of vaguely based on Kitsune, has just gone full-on Kitsune and has his tail split in 9 ways. It's amusing and strange. A lot of people have some, we'll say, strong feelings about Sonic's shoes. I could care less, but I don't know. I don't know. Some people have very strong feelings about what color Sonic's arms are. If they get his face right, if they make him emote in a very reasonable way, then sort of the style of what he's wearing or what the nuances of it are a bit meaningless to me. I mean, I'm someone who looks at the Sonic Boom character designs and said, I get everything that's going on here. I understand the reasons why you designed the characters like this in 2012, I want to say? Probably closer to, like, 2006... No, not 2012. What year is it? Oh my gosh, what year is it? How long have I been on? How long have I been trapped in this room? Sonic's a VTuber now. That's how long I've been trapped in this room. I'm guessing that, I am guessing in some ways Sega was looking at what the weird popular thing is, and they created sort of a VTuber version of Sonic, to just promote the brand. There's also discussion of Sega wanting to open up a theme park. Following Universal Studios and Super Nintendo World, and you know, just the general outstanding success of it. They're certainly trying to take advantage of it. You cannot accuse Sega of not looking at what that movie did and knowing that hey, let's do something with this. We've got new people here. Let's do things for those new people. And finally, just a bit of news that I certainly appreciate. We're finally getting the second season of Sonic Boom on Blu-ray over here in the States. I assume other countries, but I couldn't tell you for certain, at least in the U.S. It's on pre-order for September. Up on Amazon and presumably certain other outlets. And Sonic Boom Season 2 was really where I feel like they found their stride in the latter half of Season 1, and then Season 2 was them taking that into stranger directions, which Sonic Boom was strange to begin with. It began life as this sort of vague action concept, and then the cartoon, which ultimately didn't work because the game met so many development issues and released in a state that very few people were happy with. And yet the cartoon hit Cartoon Network and had a, we'll call it a strong cult following, even if it didn't necessarily do all of the expectations that Sega and Cartoon Network might have had of it. And the reason why, it was just a weird sitcom. It was just sort of this, I almost compared it to like to a Seinfeld. Just the idea that there's this group of friends who just exist in this small ecosystem and have weird attitudes about each other and have this weird nemesis. And occasionally they have to fight with weird action, but most of the time it's just strange sci-fi fantasy shenanigans. It's just weird. I love it and it's weird, and I am very curious, like, what is the next direction for her? Sonic Prime, if they decide to sort of tug on that weirdness of what Sonic Boom did, and just sort of, hey, are they going to go in a comedy direction? Are they going to go in the action direction? Are they going to find a successful way to merge the two? Man of Action is pretty okay at merging the two. They've had their successes. They've had their failures. It's hard for me to pin them down to something because I feel like their output is a bit inconsistent at times. But you know what? They have made some stuff I really, really like. Big Hero 6, for example, they were involved with both that and the animated series. So cautious optimism, we'll call it. Cautious optimism. And great optimism for this Blu-ray release, which was the original topic at hand. So, speaking of original topics at hand, I think that I've let the chill just continue a bit too long. I think, look, I'm not saying that this has been bad. I'm not saying that this has been particularly chill. We've had some things that are distinctly not chill. But what I am absolutely 100% without hesitation saying is that it's time. Let's get this party started.
Yeah.
Hey, and that was Let's Get This Party Started from Sonic Adventure and Quartz Quadrant G Mix, The Good Future, from Sonic CD, the Japanese version. We are getting close to the end of this evening. I said it'd be about an hour, and I'm sticking to that. It's still going to absolutely, definitely be roughly an hour within certain length parameters, probably closer to hour 15, etc., etc., etc. And, hey, 2020 summer, I mean, the big thing that people were expecting last year before, you know, the world happened was the Tokyo 2020 Olympics. Perhaps no one more than Sega themselves, who released their Olympics game in 2019 in expectation of it. But, I mean, eventually they then released another Olympics game without Mario and Sonic shortly thereafter. In fact, incredibly recently, you can play as a man or woman dressed in a giant Sonic mascot costume. It sounds dumb. It looks dumb. It's amazing. It's fantastic. If you head over to the Sonic Stadium YouTube, you could see site leader Dreadnux just sort of playing a pre-release copy of it with that big dopey costume, swimming in it and doing combat judo. It's weird. It's weird, and I love it, and it's weird. Get more weird crossovers, please. More weird crossovers. But we're gonna wrap tonight up with a couple of tracks. Well, wrap up, it might be a bit premature, but we're going to start winding things down for tonight with a duo of Sonic Olympic tracks. I will say this forever comfortably. I really like the Sonic and Mario and Sonic at the Olympic Games soundtracks. Like, the early ones are not especially iconic, but once you got to the winter ones, the Rio one is magic. It's just utter magic. Just, it's an amazing soundtrack, and I recommend you spend some time listening to it, but we're not gonna listen to it tonight. We're gonna listen to it in the future, so help me. Like, I will absolutely put tracks from that onto this series, because it's an amazing soundtrack. But I've got a track from the first Mario and Sonic at the Olympic Games, and I got a track from the latest Mario and Sonic at the Olympic Games. First off, we've got 4x100 meters freestyle, which is a swimming competition from the original Mario and Sonic at the Olympic Games. And shortly after that, we've got football! We've got football! Which anyone in America will be like, oh, that was in there? And everyone else in the world's like, yeah! Football! Not that thing that you Americans call football. The football that's actually football, you know, the first football. The first football that the rest of the world likes, along with our metric system and other stuff that the world likes that America doesn't follow, etc., etc., etc. Yeah, we got football. So let's listen to some swimming and some football! And then we're going to approach the end of the show. We'll be back after these two. See you on the other side. football. 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 Ooh, that jumped into the final song a bit too quickly. Yeah, so some of you already heard what we're wrapping up with tonight. But yeah, thank you to everyone in chat who popped over and got to listen to this live. And hey, thank you to everyone over on YouTube who took the time to listen to this after the fact. Certainly appreciate it. It has been a good second show, I will declare. I will declare, and nobody can stop me, certainly not any of you or the people who actually do have the authority to stop me. Braver, stronger people have tried. It's been a long week. It's been a rough week. I'm looking forward to a technically 4-day weekend. And I hope some of you are too. If not, then I hope you're at least looking forward to a nice, chill, relaxed, awesome 2 or 3 day weekend. Hopefully a good amount of weekend for you to rejuvenate. And I look through, again, just thinking about, like, hey, what can I do for an audio, what can I do for a vocal track that's going to be nice and chill, that's going to be great to start our weekend off with, to end our Friday off with, on with some amount of that. And I went with Sweet Sweet Sweet, a.k.a. the, it's a song that has an interesting history. Number one, originally composed by Dreams Come True, for use in Sonic the Hedgehog 2, the ending theme of the cutscene whenever Tails goes and grabs Sonic as he descends from the sky onto the ground to prevent him from, you know, dying. Or burning up in the atmosphere, or whatever Sonic does. I don't know. Sonic is space-proof somehow. But yeah, I chose the Japanese version, aka Sweet Sweet Sweet. I specifically chose the Akon, A-K-O-N, remix of this song from Sonic the Hedgehog 2006. And I hope you enjoy. I hope you have a good weekend. And if you're able, I hope you can pop over this time next week for another fantastic episode of SegaSonic Radio. Peace out, y'all. We are up, over, and gone. all.